So let f be a function from x to y. X metrizable topological space and y just a topological space. Then f is continuous. If and only if, so we can use sequences. But important is the x is metrizable. Then f is continuous. If and if, for every convergent sequence, xn converging to x in x, the sequence f of xn converges, so I write also, converges to f of x. So we can use sequences to characterize continuity, okay? But we need some hypothesis, otherwise it's not true. So x is metrizable. If x is not metrizable, this is not true. So let's see the proof. Here, for metric spaces, metrizable spaces, we can use sequences. So one direction is an exercise, which is easy, which I will not do. Then f is if f is continuous, so this is this direction. That's the easy, okay? Easy. Easy means just use definitions. I mean, if you think, if xn converges to x, so we take a neighborhood of f of x, the preimage is a neighborhood of x, xn converges to x, means that xn is in this neighborhood for n large, and then f of xn is in this neighborhood for n large. So this is the proof, okay, without writing. So more interesting is the other direction. Here we don't need metrizable, okay? Use definitions. We don't need metrizable here. This holds always. The other one, we need metrizable. So let A be a subset of X. What we will prove is that F of A, we will show that F of the closure of A is contained in the closure of F of A. Oh, that we prove. So this means if a point is close to A, then the image point is close to F of A. That's continuity, okay? So let X be in the closure of A. That we will prove. So this implies continuity, F continues. By some thing we proved already. So let X be in the closure of A. By the sequence lemma, there's a sequence in A which converges to X. There's a sequence. AN in A, which converges to X. To what? To X, yes. So I write AN converges to X. And here we use X is metrizable, okay? Using that X is metrizable. We need X metrizable in general here, okay? Since X is metrizable. So here we need the hypothesis. So what we have we have that f of xn converges to f of x, so by hypothesis, then f of x, so we are in this direction, yes. Then f of x, f of an converges to f of a, of f of x. By the sequence lemma again, but here we don't use metrizable, okay? By the sequence lemma. By the other direction of the sequence lemma, f of x, so this is the trivial. F of x is in the closure of f of a. So, concluding, and this implies that f, so, sorry, by the sequence lemma, f of a, here we don't use metrizable. We are in y, we don't have any hypothesis, okay? So I don't write that. So this implies that f of a closure is contained in f of a tutto, and this implies f continuous. That's a proof. So we give immediately another application of the sequence lemma. Proposition. And this is interesting. I find it interesting. R omega in the box topology is not metrizable. R omega in the box topology is not metrizable. R omega in the box topology is not metrizable. Well, we said for a box topology, nothing is true. Still, we have to prove. It's not a big surprise, maybe. But it's not proof. So the proof is interesting. This is an interesting proof. Short, easy, but interesting. We will see why interesting. So let A, so we apply the sequence lemma again. A, we take the upper half space, so these are all points with positive coordinates. So Rn in R omega, n in n, no? These are our points, n in R omega, such that all Rn are real numbers and are bigger than zero. Well, this is the upper half space, okay? The upper half space. Open upper half space, no? That's A. Then, and if zero is a point zero, zero, no? In R omega, so we just write zero, over zero, zero, all coordinates zero, then zero is in the closure of A. This is easy again, okay? So I will not write it, I will say. What means in the closure of A? So take a neighborhood of zero. In the box topology. This is a product of open sets, which contain zero. So all these open sets contain zero in R, in the reals, okay? Then they have a small interval, minus epsilon n, around zero in each component. It is open, the standard topology on R, okay? Then we take epsilon n over 2. That's the point in this interval. And this is positive, and it's in the intersection, okay? So this is easy, that's the proof, that zero is in there, okay? Exercise. Well, I said it, okay? But I will not write. Zero is in the closure. And now we will prove that there's no sequence in A converging to zero. Then the sequence lemma says, then R omega cannot be metrizable. Otherwise, we have the sequence, okay? And this is a very classical argument. So we take any sequence. So let an, how is it called? An, it's called in the book, an equal to a, so I use, I don't know, a1n, a2n, Let me call it R1n, R2n, the coordinates, and so on, in R omega. So we take, let an be this in R omega. So an is a sequence in R omega, okay? So an, so this is R mn, if you want, m in n, okay? N is fixed. So an is a sequence in R omega. And these are the coordinates. So an is a sequence in R omega. In A, because this is positive. Ah, positive. So I should write Rmn bigger than 0. So we are in A. So this is sequence in A, okay? It's sequence in A, An. All coordinates are positive. So we take a sequence in A. And then we have a neighborhood, U, which is a product minus RNN, RNN, N in N. So I have the same index now, okay? I take the same index. Minus RNN, RNN is a neighborhood of zero, obviously. These are positive numbers. It's a neighborhood of zero in R omega. That's a neighborhood. It contains zero, obviously, which does not contain any element, an. It doesn't contain anything, which does not contain any an. But why not? Well, since we look at the nth coordinate of an, okay? That's nn. Ann is not here in the nth interval, okay? Which is, it's not in minus, no, this is rnn, sorry. Rnn, okay? This is our sequence here. Nth coordinate, rnn, is not in minus rnn, rnn. Looking at the nth coordinate, looking at the diagonal, okay? The nth coordinate, we are out of this interval. So this means, so an certainly does not converge to a, to zero, okay? So an does not converge to zero. So this implies no sequence converges to zero, okay? Because this is an arbitrary sequence in A. So no sequence converges. No sequence in A converges. Of course, in R omega, we have a constant sequence, no? We take 0, 0, 0, 0. But in A, positive coordinates. So no sequence in A converges to 0. And now the sequence lemma says, implies that A is not, R omega is not metrizable. It's a box topology. In the product topology is metrizable. No, we gave the metric. No, I wrote a theorem. I wrote the metric. I didn't prove that, but in the product topology, it is metrizable. In the box topology, it's not metrizable. So what is this argument? This is a diagonal argument, okay? Who used this diagonal argument? There's a famous name associated to such a diagonal argument. No? Cantor, yes. He proved with a diagonal argument that the reals are not countable, okay? So this is a diagonal argument. Here we use exactly such a diagonal argument, okay? Diagonal argument of Cantor. So this is an interesting proof, okay? This is an interesting proof because this classical, it's easy, no? But it's a classical argument of mathematics, no? This. So, a remark, I want to emphasize this. I mean, it says not metric, this is technical more. Now, remark, I said, so zero is in A closure, but no sequence in A converges to zero. Okay? That's what, so, and no, but no sequence in A converges to zero. There's no sequence which converges to zero. Zero is in the closure, but we cannot find in general a sequence, okay? Maybe I should, I forgot something to say. So what is the limit point? Okay, limit point. X of A. So what does limit point mean? Every neighborhood intersects in a point different, okay? That's very weak. That's the definition. Every neighborhood of X intersects A in a point different from X, in another point. That's very weak. Maybe one other, just one other point, no? So it's not clear limit point. But if X is Hausdorff, maybe I forgot that. Well, not forgot. No, if X is Hausdorff, then every neighborhood of X intersects A in infinitely many points. Then every neighborhood of X intersects, you have a single point, intersects A in infinitely many points. If it's Hausdorff, you have at least infinitely many points. So how do you do this? By picture, okay? I'll give you a picture for this. Why? This is A, and here's a point X, which is a limit point. So we take a neighborhood. I make the same, but here is X, this is A, and here's the neighborhood, U. U1, neighborhood. Okay? Then it's a limit point, so we find a point here, X1, A1, in the intersection. I make my picture the proof, okay? So this is a proof. A picture. So U1 is neighborhood of X, so we have to prove infinitely many points, okay? We found one by definition. That's X1. Now X is Hausdorff. That means we find another neighborhood which does of X, which doesn't contain A1. Intersecting, we can suppose that the second one is contained in the third, in the first one. Okay? We can intersect the two neighborhoods. And then we have, so this is U2. Second neighborhood. This intersects A in at least one point. So we find here a pair A2. Okay, by the same. Now, X is Hausdorff. So we find a smaller neighborhood which doesn't contain A2. So recursively, we construct a sequence. So recursively, inductively or recursively, we construct a sequence, infinitely many points. Well, it's a sequence, okay? They are all different. A sequence is not so good because this might be constant, okay? Then we have just one point, okay? Infinitely many points. We construct infinitely many points Sequence might be constant. That's not what we want. So recursively, we construct infinity points A1, A2, A3, and so on, where in U1. That's our original neighborhood, OK? So intersecting. This is the proof by picture. If you look in the, yes. Sorry. You have to speak more. This theorem. This one? Yes. Nothing at all. No, we don't need Hausdorff here. We didn't use it, okay? I mean, the proof, you don't use Hausdorff. You just use definitions, but not Hausdorff. No, it's not. Of course, X is Hausdorff because metrizable, okay? Yes. So this is the proof. This is not the proof in the book, by the way, okay? If you look in the book, you have a more theoretical proof, okay? But here you see the sequence, okay? So we have a sequence that looks like a sequence, non-constant, okay? Or everything different. And now we know, in general, we don't find a sequence which converges, okay? If you want that, then we need another condition. If F is metrizable, if X is metrizable, then there is a sequence A1, A2 in A which converges. So we get better and better, no? First we have one point, then we have infinitely many points. If it's also metrizable, then we find a sequence which converges. Then there is a sequence in A which converges to X. That's the sequence lemma. By the sequence lemma. But without this, without metrizable, it's not true. Here's an example. Zero is in the closure of A, but no sequence in A converges to zero. Of course, this is Hausdorff space. Every neighborhood of A intersects in infinitely many points. That's clear. Okay, but there's no sequence. We can construct this construction, but here it seems to converge because we make it smaller and smaller. No, but maybe there are neighborhoods which are this way, which we don't see in such. That's a picture. Okay. So this is nice. This is interesting. And then I write. Where do I write? I write here. I write another proposition, which I will not prove, because the proof is very similar. So I write proposition. Proposition. That's in the book. If you want, you can read it. The proof is similar. If J is uncountable, if J is uncountable, then Rj, now I take a product, uncountable product of reals, okay? If it's uncountable, Rj, now we take the product topology, in the product topology. It's not metrizable. So also in the product topology, now it goes wrong, okay? R omega is the last one, then everything. It's not metrizable. Also in the product topology, okay. So I will not prove it now, okay? It's in the book. It's very similar, the structure. We define A, we have zero, which is in the closure of A, and then we prove there's no sequence. Except one has to think about how to define A now, okay? A is not the upper half space here. We have to define it a little bit different. That's in the book. Okay. Instead, I will do something else. definition. I prove, I define first countable now, okay? Because we are close to first countable here. Metric spaces are first countable. That's a model, okay? So a space, a topological space, X, is first countable. Now I have first countable. That's in the fourth chapter of the book. But it's useful to do it at this point, because we have the sequence lemma, and it holds. A topological space is first countable in a point, X in X, if there's a countable family of neighborhoods, U1, U2, U3, and so on, a countably family of neighborhoods of X, of our point X, such that every neighborhood U of X contains at least one of these, okay? Such that every neighborhood of X contains at least one UN. So UN is in U for some M. So this is first countable in a point. That's a definition of it. This is a local condition, okay? Local. First countable in a point is a local condition. X is first countable if it's first countable in every point. That's still local, but now for all points, okay? X is first countable. X is first countable if it is first countable in every point X in X, if it is first countable. In every point. In each point. X in X. So this is first countable. In a point and first countable, if it's first. Okay. So remarks. Some remarks. You can assume remarks. The first remark is we can assume that U1 contains U2, contains decreasing, okay, decreasing by taking intersections, okay, by taking intersections. So we want this condition in general, okay, but it's not always given. So this is a little bit so. If you it's not in the book. So by taking intersections, finite intersections. U1 intersection U2 intersection intersection UN. So this is a new UN, okay? And this is contained in this one and contained. Okay, so we can assume this. And then it does not contain just one neighborhood, but all neighborhoods after this, okay? Sometimes this is called a countable fundamental family of neighborhoods, okay? And then we want this condition, okay? Fundamental in some books, not in a fundamental countable system, countable family of neighborhoods. Fundamental or countable fundamental family of neighborhoods. Then in general we want this condition, but we can neighborhoods of X. Okay, so we can assume that if you want. X, so this, let me, remarks, I, 2i. The model is are metric spaces, okay? So X metric, X metrizable, or metric, implies X first countable. Just take UN equal to B D X radius 1 over n. That's X metric, X, then X is first countable. And you take UN, these balls, okay? So if you have an arbitrary neighborhood, there, by the definition of metric topology, there's epsilon, such as BX epsilon is contained in U, and then we find one n large, and then we have this condition, okay? So this is, so metric implies first countable. So maybe this is a condition we are looking for. Now, this seems to be very close to metrizable, except it's not necessarily Hausdorff. But if you add Hausdorff, then it seems we are close to metrizable. So remark, three remark. The sequence lemma holds. If X is assumed to be first countable instead of metrizable. In the sequence lemma, we have metrizable, okay? But we can take first countable. And it's the same proof. Instead of the balls, we take UN. And then it's exactly the same proof, okay? Instead of the balls, which get smaller and smaller, we get take UN, which gets smaller and smaller with this condition, okay? So if the sequence of holds, if X is assumed to be first count instead of metrizable. That means the sequence lemma cannot distinguish between spaces which are first, first countable but not metrizable, okay? That is what it means. So the sequence lemma, that's an interesting point. So the sequence lemma, or I will write this, the sequence lemma cannot distinguish. You cannot use a sequence lemma between spaces which are first countable but not metrizable. It holds for first countable. So the sequence lemma cannot distinguish between spaces which are first countable . It holds for first countable spaces. So nothing to do, okay? Which are first countable but not metrizable. If you want to prove not metrizable then, but not metrizable. If you want to prove not metrizable, which are first countable but not metrizable. If you want to prove not metrizable, we have to use something stronger than the sequence lemma. The sequence lemma is not sufficient, okay? Because, well, except you say maybe they are equivalent, okay? First countable and metrizable. well, you need Hausdorff. Maybe there are two conditions. Oh, so, so next remark. This is an interesting point also. Next remark. So Hausdorff and first countable are necessary condition for being metrizable, okay? That's clear. Hausdorff and first countable, so being Hausdorff. That's an abbreviation. And first countable, being first countable, are necessary conditions for metrizability. Are necessary conditions that we need. Are necessary conditions. We need both for metrizability. These are necessary conditions. Now, we, of course, maybe they are sufficient. No, that would be too easy. They are not sufficient. But then we have to invent something else. We cannot use the sequence lemma. We use the sequence lemma for proving not metrizable. Now we have to invent something. Yeah, we'll give an example now. I will give an example. That's also one of my favorite exercises. So there's still five. X second countable implies X first countable. Second countable implies X first countable. Okay. So proof. That's easy. So what means second countable? Countable basis, okay. So let let B be a countable basis. For X, it's second countable. So we can, and X the point, X and X. We have to prove, consider, then. So what we take? We take all B in B, B in the basis, which contain X, X in B. This is countable also. It's a countable family of neighborhoods of X. It's a countable family. It's not ordered by N, okay? For the we can order it if you want, U1, U2, but here we don't have not. Then it's a countable family of neighborhoods of X such that any neighborhood of X contains one of these by definition of basis, okay? Such that any neighborhood of X contains one of these, contains one of these. Okay. By the definition of basis, okay? By definition of basis for topologies. Well, okay. And now I give you an example of a space. We will see three, four examples of spaces which are first countable but not second countable, okay? And here we have to find some stronger arguments than the sequence lemma. For example, of course, the reals standard are first and second countable, okay? Are first and second countable. Second countable. So first we saw, second we saw already, we take intervals as basis with rational endpoints. First countable, x, so we take as un, x minus 1 over n, x plus 1 over n, so it goes to x, okay? So this is easy, both. It's second countable, and it's also first countable. Of course, if it's second countable, it is first countable, but it's easier to prove directly first countable, so un, this un, of course, you take x minus 1 over n, x plus 1 over n. Okay, that works. RL is first countable. But not second countable. That we know. That's also one of my favorites. It's not second. This proof you have to know also. You have to know all proofs, but in particular, this is one of the proofs which is RL is first countable, but not second countable. That we proved already, not second countable. Okay, first countable is like this. So take un, what do we take? We take x, x plus 1 over n, no? As this un. That works. Okay, RL is, so we have a problem. Is it metrizable? That's the question now, okay? So here we have first countable. We have first countable, yeah, that's necessary. We have Hausdorff, okay? Is it metrizable? So it's not metrizable, but how to prove that? That's an exercise, the most interesting exercise so in the fourth chapter. So proposition. So I will continue here, proposition. So this is, as I said, this is an exercise. So you can look in the book for that. This is exercise, I wrote so small that I cannot read. 5A, page 194. So exercise. Exercise 5, page 194. That's the fourth chapter. We are the second first countable. We are in the fourth chapter, okay, of the book. So this is an exercise in the fourth chapter, exercise 5 on this page. As I said, this is one of my favorite exercises of the course also, okay. So what does it say? So if x is metric, metrizable. Metric and metrizable, we can write metric or metrizable is the same, okay? If x is metrizable and contains a countable dense subset D, that means the closure of D is everything, okay? A countable dense subset, then X is second countable. Corollary, I will prove this, okay? I will do this exercise. I didn't give it last week, okay? I will do it now because this is one of the most interesting exercises, okay, of the in the book. Corollary, RL is not metrizable. It is first countable, but it is not metrizable, so it's not sufficient. Hausdorff, of course. RL is not metrizable. Proof, of the corollary, the rationals are dense in RL, okay? They are dense in R, but also in RL. Q is dense in RL. Every basis element of the lower limit contains a rational, okay? Every interval of whatever type contains a rational. Half open, open. Close if it's not one point. So Q is dense in RL. And it's not second countable, that we know. That we have to use here, okay? And not second countable. And RL is not second countable. That we know already. It's not second countable. If it would be metric, metrizable, then it would be second countable. Okay? So I will prove this now. Proof. Of the proposition, not of the corollary. The corollary is okay. So the proposition. Well, it's also this is it's easy, okay? As you see now, we'll see now. It's easy proof. If one does it in the right way, okay? If you have a not the right approach, then it gets messy, okay? So what? So we have this. X is metrizable and contains a countable dense subset. So we have to find a countable basis, no? It's clear what should be the countable basis. So B is equal. Well, we have a metric space, so we take balls, BD. Of Y with radius 1 over n, where Y is in D, that's countable, and n is in n, that's also countable. So let B, so this is a countable family of open sets, countable family. And now we apply the family of open sets. And now we apply the usual basis recognition lemma, okay, to prove it's a basis, okay? This is a basis. So what we have to prove? I make a figure. So let U be open. And take a point, x and x. So here we have u, and we take a point, x. So we have a metric space, so there is then the ball. I want to work with the ball around x. So we have some ball around x, which is contained in u. There's a metric topology, okay? And the radius, some epsilon, but I take 1 over n immediately. It's convenient for some n, okay? 1 over n is contained in u for some n in n. So here we have a ball now. So this radius is 1 over n. Maybe x is not in D, no, that's the problem, okay? If x is not in D, we cannot take this one, okay? We need a center in D, right? If x is in D, that's it, okay? If x is not in D, we have to find. So what the trick is to make half the radius. So this is 1 over n, and now take half radius, this is x, half radius. So this is radius 1 over 2n. Around x. Okay, so I take half the, we will see immediately from the picture that this is okay. So let y But it's dense, right? D is dense. What means dense? Dense means every open set contains a point in D, okay? Otherwise, the closure would not be everything, okay? So we take a point here. Here is a point, Y. So let Y be in B, D, X, 1 over 2n I want. It's convenient, 1 over 2n, okay? It's clear that it's convenient. Then, of course, that's trivial. X is in B, D, Y, 1 over 2n, no? Which is in our basis. How is it called? B. This is in B now, okay? And contains X. And BD X 1 over 2n. Sorry, Y. Again, Y. This one is contained in BD X 1 over n. And this is contained in U. So the, now the basis recognition lemma says B is the basis. That's the basis recognition. Lemma implies B is the basis for X. Well, it's clear here. Now you see from the picture, you have, you take a radius 1 over n. So it looks like this, but you don't go over, okay? It's clear now from the picture, more or less, okay? You don't touch this one. That's, of course, a triangle inequality. So proof, I will prove. So this, so proof, so let Y, let Z be in BD, Y, 1 over 2N. So we want to prove Z is here also, okay? So it's contained here. So the distance of Z and X. So distance of Z, that's the usual triangular inequality. We compare with Y, ZY plus DYX. So this is smaller than. ZY, where's Z? Oops. So this is smaller than 1 over 2n, okay? Because Z is in this ball, okay? So 1 over 2n plus, and XY, we have also 1 over 2n. So this is 1 over n. So this implies that Z is in BD X 1 over n. So this finishes the proof, okay, of the exercise. That's an exercise. But it's one of the most interesting exercises. So this is a space which is first countable, but not metrizable, okay? So first countable is not sufficient. And we will see other examples. Here we have countably many choices of Y only. Okay? And here we have countably many choices. So countable times countable is countable. That's exactly here we use it, okay? If you take arbitrary many points, it's not countable, okay? If you take all points, it's not countable, maybe. But Y is in D, and D is countable. So this is countable. N times N, the natural numbers is countable, right? N times n is countable. That's another diagonal argument, if you want, okay? You have 1n, 2n, 3 times, 4 times n, and then you count in this diagonal, okay? Right? N times n is countable. Countable times countable is countable. So is that okay? Yes. So this exercise, which I didn't give, but which I did now, okay? But it's... So where are we? This is the last thing. So here. So now this finishes the first chapter, and also part of the fourth chapter, okay? So first, second council, that's the fourth chapter. And now I gave with the second one. Second is connected spaces. That's the second. The first one was topology, basis, examples, okay, many examples. And the second chapter is connected spaces. So we restart, okay, in some sense of it. But we will see. So the most interesting example in this case is RL, okay? R omega maybe, RL. Here we will see another very strange but very interesting example in this chapter here. So what is connected? So definition. We start with definitions again. So a separation of, that's a way of talking, a separation of a topological space X. How do you say? It's a pair. XY of subsets of X such that. So we have, we write the conditions, we, what we want. A pair XY of subsets of X that XY are open. XY are open. That's not, I don't like, sorry. UV. A separation of topological space, because the topological space in general is X. The separation of topological space is, okay, the topological space is always X. So I shouldn't call this XY, but UV is a pair UV of subsets. U and V are open in X, okay? U and V. Four conditions. U, V are open, and V are open in X. Second one, X is a union. It's everything. Third, the intersection is empty. And the last condition? Non-empty, of course. Otherwise, it's trivial. No, if you take empty and the whole, U and V are not empty. So these are the four conditions for a separation. So it's convenient to call it separation. Then we have these conditions. Then we know these four conditions. You don't have to write it every time, okay? So remark, U and V are also closed, okay? It's called a complement. Both open, both closed. So X is connected if there is no separation for X, okay? X is connected.
if there is no separation
of X. So this is connected. That's a definition. That's a reasonable condition, okay? And now we have some small lemmas, as usual. We start from beginning, okay? So we prove some easy stuff first, okay? It's easy properties, as usual. But at the end, it gets more and more interesting, as usual. Also, the first chapter today certainly was the most interesting part of the first chapter, okay? And also here, we start with easy stuff, and at the end, we see this example, which is called the ordered square, which has nice properties. It's a strange space, but then we will do a third chapter, compact spaces, and there's another example, which is S omega, called S omega, okay, which is also strange space with very interesting properties. And the fourth chapter is normal spaces and metrization theorems, okay? This is the idea of the course, okay? So some small lemma. If X U equals U, U union V is a separation and U, no, and Y contained in X is connected, is a connected, so very often we say connected subset, okay, but of course we mean subspace, okay, it's not so clear, no, but we say subset, it's a connected subset of X, so subspace with the subspace topology, clearly, okay? That's what this means. Subspace with the subspace topology. But very often we say subset, okay? Connected subset means connected subset in the subspace topology, okay? Then Y is contained, should be contained in U, or Y should be contained in V. Okay. So the proof is, the proofs are very easy at this point, short. So Y is equal to, of course, Y intersection U union Y intersection V. And let's look at these. These are open in Y, no? Open in Y, because intersection with open sets in the whole space. So they're subspace topology, okay? So they're open in Y, disjoint. So this is a separation of Y. No. There's no separation. Y is connected. So it's open, they are disjoint. What do we need? Open in Y. Disjoint, the union is everything, okay? But Y has no separation. Y has no separation. Because it's connected. So what is missing? The last condition, okay? So this implies Y intersection U is empty. And this means that Y is contained in V, or Y intersection V is empty. And this means Y is contained in U. And that's the whole proof. So that's an easy two-line proof. Next one, so I pass to the other blackboard, to the other side of the blackboard, so I can go back. Okay, lemma. Another, next lemma. Very easy results. If A alpha are connected, A alpha in X are connected for some index set, alpha in J, always in the book, alpha in J, and have one point in, have non-intersect, and in, intersection here, alpha in J, non-empty. They have one point in common, okay? At least one point in common. Then the union is connected. So this means the union, less technical. Sometimes it's useful to write in a less technical way. The union, a union of connected spaces, of connected subsets, subspaces, a union of connected subsets which have at least one point in common. Is connected. Well, maybe I shouldn't have written that, but this is less technical. No, this is, we have very many symbols. So the proof is, again, very easy. So we take a point. Let X be in the intersection A alpha, alpha and J. Take a point, the intersection is not empty, no, alpha. This non-empty intersection, take a point. And Y is a union. We have to prove that this is connected, alpha and J. So we'll call it Y, well, anyway. Suppose we have a separation. We have to prove it's connected, okay? Suppose we make a stupid contradiction, but it's easier to write. That's the only reason, okay? We can avoid contradiction. That's a fake contradiction. Suppose Y equal C union D, U, V is a separation. Because otherwise, I have to write three conditions. It's a separation of Y, of course. Suppose, so we have P, no? How is it called? Our point. Where is it point? X. Here it is. X, okay? Suppose X is in, well, it must be in C or D, so let's suppose it's in C, okay? By the first lemma, A alpha is in C. A alpha is connected, no? By the first lemma, by the preceding lemma, A alpha is contained in C. Because P, X is in C, okay? So it must be in C, not in D. For all alpha and J. And this, of course, means that the union A alpha, alpha and J, is everything here is contained in C. No? Everything is in C. So D is empty. And this implies there's no D. So this is not a separation, okay? Fake contradiction. Okay. Next. So this is a proposition. Proposition. Of course, we need examples of connected spaces. Now, these are easy consequences of the definition, okay? The interesting thing is to prove something is connected and have applications of such a thing, okay? This is very formal, okay? We will see, not today, but tomorrow. The proposition, let A, subset of X, be connected, so A connected. A and X connected subset if A is contained in B and contained in the closure of A, then B is connected. In particular, A closure is connected. In particular, that's a special case. In particular, the closure of A is connected. So this, we can say, the closure of a connected set is connected, always, okay? This is very short and easy to. So the closure of a connected set is connected. Okay, so let's prove that. Suppose we have a separation. What do you have to prove? That B is connected. Suppose we have a separation, okay? Suppose that B is equal to a separation which is called C union D is a separation. Of B, of course. By the lemma, by the first lemma, A is contained in C, A is connected, no? A is connected. So by the first lemma, A is contained in C, or A is contained in D, no? Because A is connected. Suppose A is in C. Suppose A is contained in C. Then the closure of A is contained in the closure of C. And so B, and this implies, and so B is contained in C. So B is contained in C, no? So B is contained in C bar intersection B. Oh, that's trivial after with this, no? So B is contained in C. But what is this? This is a closure. What is this? Sorry, I should be more clear. The closures here are in X, if you write this way, okay? So we have to add that. Closures, if you write this, then we refer to the whole space, which is X, okay? So So closures in X. If you write this symbol, that means in X. Closures in X, not in some subspace. Okay? The closure with this symbol is always in the whole space. So this is the closure of C in B. So how do we get the closure of C in B? We take the closure of C in X and intersect with B. That's a lemma, by a lemma, okay? By some lemma. By a lemma, which we proved in the first. Maybe, I don't know, we proved or we did not prove. Okay, so this is a closure of C in B. But C is closed in B, no? That's the separation. So B is closed in C is closed in B. But C is closed in B. So what? I'm lost. So B is in C, no? So this is what? This is a closure of C in B, which is equal to C, no? It's closed, okay? So it's equal to C. Yes, it's closed. C is closed in B, so it's C. So B is contained in, what do we want to prove? So B is contained in C. Ah, we have the separation here, okay? So it's, everything is here, so D is empty. So this implies D, there's no D. Okay? So fake contradiction, okay? This was not the separation. Next one, proposition. Very, today the easy, tomorrow the interesting. More interesting. So proposition. So if F from X to Y is continuous, and X is connected, then also f of x is connected. So this, less technical set, a continuous image of a connected set is connected, okay? A continuous image. The map has to be continuous, of course. A continuous image of a connected set or connected space, X, but connected set. Also for subsets, connected subsets. Of a connected set is connected. So that's what it says. Unless. Also here, the proofs are easy. Proof. Well, this we can assume it's convenient. That's we can assume that F is surjective. We can assume that F is surjective. I.e. F of X, that means F of X is equal to Y. So why is that? Since a co-restriction of a continuous map is continuous, okay? We can restrict a co-restriction, also the restriction, okay, both, co-restriction, restriction. So a very formal, a co-restriction of a continuous map. So co-restriction means a restriction in the image, okay, on the image. Restriction means a restriction on the pre-image, okay? A co-restriction of a continuous map is continuous. So this is two lines. That's no proof. Also, a restriction of a continuous map is continuous, okay? Also, a restriction, also. Since the co-restriction of a continuous map is also the restriction of a continuous map, but that doesn't have to do with this proof now, but also a restriction of a continuous map is continuous. These are, if you want, very easy exercises, okay, which I will not do. Co-restriction, restriction. So we have to prove that f of x, which is y, is connected. F of x, so suppose we have a separation, okay? Suppose, again, fake contradiction. Suppose f of x, which is y. We have a separation which is called, how is it called? I don't know, I don't, just disconnect. A, B, well, doesn't matter. C, D, now it's A, B. Suppose F of X or Y is equal to A, B, it's a separation. Of y. That, why we need this surjective? Now, this means a and b are open, okay, in y. Okay, if it's not surjective, they are open in the image, maybe, but not open in the whole space. No, that's the point. So, a and b are open in y. If it's not surjective, they are maybe not open in Y, okay? They are open in F of X. So pre-image of open sets are open. This is so. Then X is equal to F minus 1 of A union F minus 1 of B. So pre-image of open sets are open. So these are open. A and B are disjoint, so these are disjoint. It's all X. What do you want to prove? So, we look for a contradiction, no? So it's a separation, I say. No, that's a separation. It's a separation. And this is a fake contradiction, again, we don't have a separation, no? So we need that it's non-empty, F minus 1 of A. Why it's not empty? Because they're not empty because it's surjective also, okay? They are non-empty since A and B are non-empty, no? And then they are non-empty since F is surjective. Okay, so it's a separation. And then we have, again, the same fake contradiction. There's no separation. So that's a contradiction. So, what is next? That I will not prove. So we have 3 minutes, and I give a definition and the theorem, which we start proving tomorrow. The first, a little bit more important theorem, that's the last for today, okay? 3 minutes, all right. First a definition and then a theorem. And then I will start tomorrow with the proof of the theorem. So definition. An ordered set, a simply ordered set, so we have an order, L. Well, in the book it's called L, I don't know. With more than one element, we don't want a point element. It's a linear continuum. So we define linear continuum. Continuum. So that's what we want to define. It's a linear continuum if two conditions hold. The first one is L has the least upper bound property. That's a very interesting condition, the least upper bound property. What does it mean? That means every non-empty subset and every non-empty subset bounded from above has the least upper bound, okay? Every non-empty bounded subset from above, of course, here. Bounded subset has a least upper bound. Supremum, or sup, least upper bound. Every non-empty bounded subset has a least upper bound. And the second condition is we need enough points, okay? If x and y are in L, x smaller than y, then there is a third point between them. There is z in L such that z is between x and y. So we have enough points, okay? So examples, that's the last point now. Example. The standard example, of course, are the reals, okay? That's a linear continuum. Example R. That's a linear continuum, okay? The least upper bound property is the important property, okay? R is the standard example. But not Q. No? This has not the least upper bound property, clearly, okay? R, yes. That's why we need R, and not Q is not sufficient, okay? So R, but not Q. These are the standard example. And then tomorrow we see a non-standard example also, okay? And that's the second important example of the book, the ordered square. Okay, so then I finish for today. And tomorrow we prove a theorem now. If you have such a linear continuum, then it is connected, okay? Something like that. Okay, so that's the first more important theorem tomorrow, which I will prove. A linear continuum is connected, okay? The reals are connected, but one has to prove that, okay? In general, it's easy to prove that the space is not connected. You just have to find a separation. It is difficult to prove, but it's easy to prove, not connected, but useless, okay? It is, in general, you have to work to prove connected, but this is useful for applications, okay? That's the idea, okay? Not connected, easy, okay? Always easy, not connect, prove not connected. You find the separation, you see. Proving that it's connected is difficult. But the first thing is not useful. The second one has many applications, okay? So that's the general philosophy. Connected, not connected. Okay, so I will finish because it seems there's another lecture at 4, at 5:30. So that's what he told me, okay? Anyway, we have at 5:30, okay? So we go on tomorrow with connected spaces.